Our next speaker is Dr. Shawna Pandya. Dr. Pandya is a physician, scientist, astronaut candidate with Project Possum, an aquanaut, speaker, martial artist, advanced diver, skydiver, pilot in training. Boy, making me feel inadequate here. VP of Immersive Medicine with Luxonic Technologies, Director of Medical Research at Orbital Assembly Construction, and Fellow of the Explorers Club. She's also Director of the International Institute of Astronautical Sciences, Possum Space Medicine Group, Chief Instructor at the IIAS Possum Operational Space Medicine Course, Clinical Lecturer at the University of Alberta, podcast host with World Extreme Medicine's WEMcast series. She's the PI for the SHAD Canada Blue Origin Student Microgravity Competition, member of the SN 2021 Guiding Coalition, licensed team lead for the Association of Spaceflight Professionals. I don't know how she has time for all this. She also serves as medical advisor to several space medical and technology companies. Dr. Pandya was part of the first crew to test a commercial spacesuit in weightlessness in 2015. And she is going to talk about medicine on the moon, Mars, and beyond, lessons from human health challenges in spaceflight for space and Earth. Dr. Pandya?
Great, thank you so much. You can hear and see me okay and hear, see my slides?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so we have 20 minutes, 60 slides, a whole lot of caffeine on board. And Marsha, I've got one up on you. I'm working in the ER right now, so we are going to make this smooth and efficient. Thank you for those great presentations we've seen so far today. So you've heard a little bit about my background, and we're going to talk a little bit more about what the EVA, IVA spacesuit testing entails. You've heard about my affiliations. We're not going to go over them too much here because I'm going to talk to you a little bit more in the second part about my talk about some of my work. But let's start with a simple thought experiment. Imagine that you are going to the moon today and you are the crew doctor. What are you going to pack with you? In order to know what you're packing with you, you need to know what you're packing for. And that entails, first of all, knowing the environment you're heading into. And so with this audience, I probably don't need to belabor this point too much, but there's a whole host of laundry list of things that can threaten human health in space, everything from the acceleration, deceleration loads of launch to increased radiation to altered day-night cycles. So that's 16 sunrise, sunset cycles on the International Space Station, one every 90 minutes, temperature extremes, needing to be a good crewmate in isolation and confinement. No one wants to be that astronaut that is kicked off the habitat. The everyday lumps and bumps and risks of things we would see on Earth. And of course, the big thing that we all think of when we talk about going to space, and that's microgravity. And the summary, because I'm sure that lots of speakers have alluded to this already, is that every single bodily system is affected by the spaceflight environment. So our bones lose density at a rate of 1.5% per month. That doesn't plateau, that continues reflecting an osteoporotic state on Earth. Our muscles lose mass, our fluid shifts upwards, which has consequences for fluid load, cardiac interpretation of that fluid load, peeing out more of that fluid in the first few days on station. You've heard about how our neurovestibular systems are affected, especially with that space adaptation sickness for the first 72 hours on station. That's why we don't schedule critical activities like space walks on the first and within that first critical time period. And then in longer duration space flight, the CSF, that cerebrospinal fluid, the brain juices that bathe our spines and our brains tends to hang out around our optic nerves. And there's impaired CSF, lymphatic and venous drainage, in fact, leading to increased pressure on the backs of our optic nerves. So you can see that pale dot here at the back of the retina. This tends to affect men preferentially compared to female astronauts. Speaking of which, we know there's additional gender differences. So for example, female astronauts are more prone to bladder infections, and that's a matter of anatomy having shorter urethras. They're more prone to that orthostatic intolerance, whereas males, we just discussed, are more prone to the set-based adaptation neuroocular syndrome. But overall, we notice there's no differences in cognition and performance. And the surprises keep coming. As recently as 2019, on routine handheld ultrasound of the jugular veins, we found that an astronaut had developed a blood clot in space. So now we have to ask ourselves, is space a procoagulable state? Are we more prone to blood clots and venous stasis when we're in that microgravity environment? And how do we prevent that? And what is it about the spaceflight environment? So all this is to say what all the other speakers have been telling you already, and that is simply that space is trying to kill you. And this is just what we know from data from decades of human spaceflight in low Earth orbit. And so the question becomes then, what happens when we go beyond LEO? And this isn't simply a theoretical question, because we have very real plans to go to the moon and beyond, which we'll talk about in a couple of slides. But to summarize these expanded challenges, they can be boiled down to the big five, which include altered gravity environments. So we talked about microgravity that affects on the body so far. But what about lunar gravity, 17%, Martian gravity, 38%, distance from Earth? And the reason why that matters, that the further away we go, the more of a time delay there is. So at the ultimate, the furthest conjunction of Mars and Earth, you could be waiting to have a 46-minute round-trip communication delay. So that means if you have a mass hemorrhage or major trauma on Mars, you don't have time to wait for assistance from Earth. You also have to deal with increased radiation. So once you're beyond the confines of the Van Allen belts, even further out than the space station, you have to worry about increased radiation exposure. So that's the equivalent of a full body CAT scan every 5 to 6 days on route to Mars. You have to again worry about the psychological effects of isolation, confinement, and everything else which falls under hostile environments. So that means those altered day-night cycles. That means the threat of lunar dust, which we know from the Apollo era was a very real skin and respiratory tract irritant. It clogged up the joints of suits. And why are we talking about this? Well, here's the exploration roadmap of NASA and the international community. So this starts with Lunar Gateway as starting assembly as early as 2022, non-continuously crewed operations for 3 months at a time, starting in 2026. With purposes of science, lunar sun observation, as well as serving as a waypoint to the lunar surface. Speaking of which, those of you who follow lunar and human exploration plans will know about Artemis, the plan to put the first woman and next man on the moon as early as 2024. And of course, using the moon as a science and exploration bed, a plan to establish permanent surface operations by the end of the decade, and of course, serve as a waypoint to Mars. And it's not just the space agencies, it's not just NASA, ESA, CSA, but the commercial space sector is getting into the game as well. Elon Musk of SpaceX has famously said that he plans to send humans to Mars as early as the 2030s. So now that I've effectively stressed you out, let's return to that initial question. You're the crew doctor. What do you pack now? So the other part of the equation is knowing what tools you have at your disposal to help you prepare for space. So that starts with prevention. Currently, within the domain of space agency selections, we select the healthiest of the healthy. I like to say that the path towards becoming an astronaut is littered with the hopes and dreams of medically disqualified candidates along the way. This continues with pre, post, and in-flight rehab. So add in-flight countermeasures. So astronauts famously have to perform 1.5 to 2 hours of aerobic and resistive exercise for 6 days a week to prevent that bone and muscle mass loss that we talked about. It has to do with continuing nutrition. So we're congested on space station. We have to find foods that have a long shelf life, that are flavorful, savory, nutritious, but also low weight. And it also continues with in-flight measures, having a crew medical officer with 40 hours of training, onboard medical kit, procedures, protocols, as well as pre-flight quarantine. There's also computer modeling techniques. Here's a snapshot of the integrated medical model that our colleagues at JSC Exploration Medical Capability use. So based on data from previous human spaceflight, you input what your crew profile is, size of your crew, the duration of your mission, your accepted parameters for loss of crew, loss of life, as well as what you'll extrapolate upon based on medical kit contents of the ISS, and then expand that out. But those of you who are paying close attention saying, well, what happens if you have a UTI, a trauma, and a foreign body in the eye all on the same trip, and what order that happens in can actually affect what supplies you end up using. That's a very good point, which is why NASA also uses the medical extensible probability risk assessment, medical extensible dynamic probability risk assessment tool, which is cumbersome, which is why we call it the MedPRAT, which is based on neural networks and Bayesian modeling, which is able to accommodate for multiple medical events at different time points in a mission to be able to generate different outcomes. The other part of the what of knowing the tools and the risks is knowing what has happened in human spaceflight in the past. So when we, this is a list of the top 100 conditions that we plan for in human spaceflight, everything from terrifying things like cardiac arrest and mass trauma to benign things like congestion headaches to equally terrifying but benign things like diarrhea in space. And the final part of the equation is knowing how to pack for space. And we talk about the backpacking principle. So this is, think of going on a hiking trip. Everything that you bring with you comes at the expense of something else. So you only have so much volume. I like to call this the Aladdin principle of space because you have infinite cosmic power to get to space, itty bitty living space. So to summarize, when you're packing for space, everything that you bring with you is low cost, low volume, low mass, has to have a long shelf life, easy to use, and has to be hardy. The final part of this, when we expand out how we're thinking about packing for space, is knowing what's on the human research roadmap when it talks to exploration class missions and beyond. So this includes everything we've alluded to so far, like bone density concerns, radiation exposure, exposure to lunar dust, to crew dynamics, to things that we don't really intuitively think about, like human computer interfaces, to loss of skills over the course of a long duration mission. So in the final part of this talk, I want to get to how do we prepare for exploration class missions. So let's start with a question. What is that gold standard that we're aspiring to? And if we had no constraints, it would simply be to bring another Earth with us to Mars. So then we don't have to worry about gravity and radiation and enclosed loop life support system. So then let's ask a second question. What if we didn't just provide a standard of care on Mars, but what if we surpassed it? How do we do that? What if we took inspiration from emerging technologies and science fiction? What if we could create artificial gravity rotating space stations like Space Odyssey 2001? What if we could create exoskeletons to bring with us to help decompensated astronauts perform meaningful work on the surface of Mars? What if we could prevent skills deterioration by simply uploading skills to our brains like in the Matrix? Or what if we said, you know what, that's too much work and too much risk. Why don't we just send avatars to Mars? So the future is closer than we think. I'm just going to take the next couple of slides to talk you through some of the work I'm focusing on. So with Luxonic Technologies, we've created virtual reality medical procedural training toolkits for exploration class missions. So here's me testing a different suite. This is our radiology suite that allows physicians in different locations to collaborate and review imaging in a virtual space. So I was in an underwater research habitat on the 5-day Aquanaut mission when I tested this, and I liaised with the head of radiology in Canada, 4,600 kilometers away from the Florida Keys. Here's a snapshot of an EVA trauma module that we've developed for the Canadian Space Agency. We don't have time to show the video, but basically this allows us to practice those medical skills in VR in order to maintain that skill set. We talked about the science fiction of rotating partial gravity space stations. Well, I'm here to tell you that that's actually a real principle we're working on today. So me and my colleagues at Orbital Assembly Corporation are creating research for research platforms and commercial platforms for both uncrewed as well as human intended activity and research. So Space Odyssey 2001 is coming to life. And then I'm also advisor to a company that was formerly called Mission Space Food and is now called Astrius. And this looks at the problem of creating affordable, nutritious, long duration, long shelf life food that is textured, flavorful, nutritionally and calorically meaningful, that also is that astronauts will want to eat. So elsewhere, let's look outside elsewhere to where else we're borrowing from ideas from science fiction. So here's a snapshot of an article from the MIT Technology Review 2016, borrowing from the science fiction movie Gattaca, talking about genetically augmenting humans to make them more prepared for high risk environments, high radiation environments. And there is precedent for this. So last year on the International Space Station, the Rodent Research 19 experiment was set up to the ISS. And basically they took out these genetically engineered mice, these jacked up little mice you see on the left that had more muscle mass. And then they had groups of flown and non-flown mice. And then the other experimental variable they introduced was something called the ACVR2 neuromuscular blockade, which prevented muscle and bone breakdown. And then they found that these jacked up little mice actually experienced less muscle mass loss and less bone density breakdown. So NASA is literally engineering Mighty Mouse. And so what I'm getting at is if we propose to successfully send humans to the moon, Mars, and beyond, we are going to have to engineer the space out of this with a little bit of space MacGyvering as well. So let's look to the future now and see what other questions remain to be solved and how we can bring those lessons back to Earth. So we know that the nature of the activities that we're going to be performing on a lunar and Martian EVA are going to change. That changes the nature of the medical risks, such as trauma, falls that we have to contend with. So we also have to be asking in tandem how our medical capabilities for EVA need to change as well. And along with that, how do we go about creating those permanent off-world medical capabilities? Remember, first hospitals had to happen somewhere. They happened in Jamestown. They happened anywhere humans went, and they're going to happen on the moon and Mars as well. And we also have to look at successful models such as refugee camps, military deployments, and even what's been done on the ISS when we look at how we're going to go about building those capabilities and training those personnel. And then we also have to keep in mind our packing constraints and say, how are we going to build the trauma bay of the future on Mars, knowing that we're mass volume power limited? And we also have to ask in tandem with that, how are we going to train that next generation of moon and Mars doctors? And of course, we couldn't get away without having this talk in the era of COVID-19 without asking, how are we going to handle the first moondemic? Are we going to require social distancing to 36 feet in an environment that has 1/6 gravity? And then if we're truly serious about creating and maintaining the standard of healthcare, how do we expand those regulations? What does that regulatory body look like? Do we have to expand from a World Health Organization to a Galactic Health Organization? And if we truly care about having multiple, becoming a multi-planetary faring species, that implies settlements, that implies being multi-generational, what are the challenges that come with reproduction in altered gravity, high radiation environments? And I know we've had a couple speakers speaking to this exact problem, but the bottom line is further study is needed. And of course, we're a resourceful, clever, resilient species. So I have no doubt that we will overcome these challenges. So then the question becomes, once we go to Mars, where do we go to next? So in the last 2 minutes, let's bring it back home to Earth, because you may have noticed that when we're talking about these austere, resource limited, isolated, confined, remote environments, there may be something in common between the International Space Station, a polar deployment, a rural village in India, and an underwater research base. And if you look at the distribution of the rural population of this planet, as of 2019, 44% of the Earth's population was rural. So then we should also be asking, how do we take these technology advancements and these lessons learned and bring them back to our most in need populations on Earth? And this is already happening today. So here are but a few examples of spin-off technologies that have benefited space that have also benefited terrestrial medicine on Earth, from iodine resin filters that have been used for water filtration on Earth, as well as for villages in Kenya, to handheld ultrasounds, to solar-powered refrigerators to keep vaccines cool in areas without electricity, to atmospheric scrubbers used to keep the atmosphere clean on ISS, used in transportation chains for produce to extend the shelf life of that produce. So what I hope to have convinced you of over the course of these 20 minutes is that space is hard, space is risky, space is expensive, and a lot of these problems extend to Earth, and we have no shortage of problems to answer. But that means we just need all comers and all brains. We need you. So thank you very much. And hopefully we'll connect afterwards to answer questions. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Shawna.